Thank you. Good evening.
Good evening.
And Merry Christmas to everyone as we gather together to celebrate the birth of our Lord. You will need your hymnal throughout the service until we come to Silent Night and the final hymn, Joy to the World. At that point, you will need the green sheet that has been inserted into the bulletin. So I invite those who came without difficulty to please stand as we begin our worship with O Come All Ye Faithful, hymn number 283 in the back of your worship. Hymn number 283.
Thank you.
shine with the brightness of the true light. Grant that here on earth we may walk in the light of Jesus' presence, and in the last day wake to the brightness of his glory, through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated, and I ask that you turn to hymn number 276, Infant Holy, as the Advent wreath in Christ handled.
Oh,
second chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration, and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son, wrapped him in bands of cloth, and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over the flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah of the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly, there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." When the angel had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about the child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Thank you.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. After a woman gave birth to her firstborn child, after it was several weeks old, she decided to have a party with some of her friends to celebrate the baby's birth. And so the day of the party came, and her friends came over, and they celebrated, and they ate, and they drank, and they were having just a wonderful time. And as the afternoon wore on, finally one of the guests said, "Well, when are you going to show us the baby?" So the mother went into the baby's bedroom and looked down in the cradle, and the baby was missing. The mother began to panic. She began to fear. And then suddenly, she remembered where the baby was. The baby had been dropped off at her parents' early in the morning so that she could prepare for the party. So they were having a party for a baby who wasn't even there and who they were ignoring. But welcome to Christmas in America in 2017. A Christmas in which every year we see a party for a baby who is ignored more and more. Instead of celebrating the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ, society wants us to look at Christmas as a day of Santa Claus, Frosty the Snowman, Winter Wonderland, and toys for us. But what people fail to remember is way back in the 19th century, when the hero of the Union, General Ulysses S. Grant, was elected President of the United States, he submitted legislation to Congress making Christmas, the celebration of the birth of Christ, a national holiday. And so this is a national holiday celebrating Christ. But as we look at society, we would never know. Since Thanksgiving, I've had my radio on several different Christmas stations. For every one Christmas carol proclaiming the birth of Jesus Christ, there have been five or six winter songs. Winter Wonderland, Frosty the Snowman, It's Cold Outside, Stay a Little Longer. Or the songs have been about Santa Claus. Rarely are they about the birth of Jesus Christ. So here we have a society that is pushing out a loving Jesus Christ, a baby who came into the world for the sole purpose of saving us, and replacing it with a judgmental Santa Claus. Have you ever stopped to think about old Santa Claus? Now, what's that song, Santa Claus is coming to town? You better not cry, you better not pout, better not, whatever I'm telling you, why Santa Claus is coming to town. He knows when you're asleep, he knows when you're awake, he knows if you've been bad or good, so be good for goodness sake. Now, Santa will bring you a gift if you've been good, but if you've been naughty instead of nice, he will ignore you. Of course, as we became older, I'm sure some of you, like me, began to question old Santa and his knowledge, because according to the song, Santa knows if we're good or bad. Yet when you went to see Santa and you hopped upon the knee, what was the first question he asked you? Have you been a good boy or girl this year? Like, wait a minute, if you're keeping a list of who's naughty enough, why don't you know what I've been before I get on your knee? And usually when you got on his knee, you probably came from home where you've been fighting with your brother or sister or yelling at your parents, which would disqualify. The more I look at old Santa, the more I think he's a closet Puritan. You remember the Puritans? Those wonderful Christian sect that got kicked out of every country they tried to settle in until they came to America. England didn't want them, the Netherlands didn't want them, so they ended up in New England. And they despised Christmas. They thought that celebrating Christmas took away from the Lord's Day on Sunday. And so they outlawed the celebration of Christmas. And they demanded by law that stores be open on Christmas. And if you weren't open because you were an Anglican or you were a Presbyterian or a Lutheran or Congregationalist, a Roman Catholic, you wanted to be closed, you were threatened with prosecution for not being open. And so good old Puritans tried to make Christmas obsolete. And they would sit around in the cold, on their chair, looking out the window as their nose turned blue, spying on one another, trying to catch one another doing one simple violation of Puritanic law or Puritanic belief. See, Santa, naughty or nice? Nice, get a reward. Bad, not naughty, you get a lump of coal. But then there's Jesus. Holy Jesus, meek and mild. We're going to sing in a moment, "What Child Is This Who Lays to Rest on Mary's Lap Asleep?" Jesus, who came into the world, and not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through Him. So unlike Santa, for whom you can be too naughty, with Jesus, you can never be too bad for Jesus. No matter what kind of mess you make of your life, no matter how many times you repeat the same errors, no matter how many times you have the same disagreement with your spouse, no matter how many times you have the same rebellion against your parents, no matter how many times you fight with your brothers or sisters, Jesus still loves you. Jesus still takes you back. Jesus comes not to judge, but to serve. He comes not to bring terror, but to bring life. As one Christian theologian put it this way, quote, "If our greatest need had been information, God would have sent us an educator. If our greatest need had been technology, God would have sent us a scientist. If our greatest need had been money, God would have sent us an economist. If our greatest need had been pleasure, God would have sent us an entertainer. But our greatest need is forgiveness. So God sent us a Savior." And He sent a Savior, as we read in our gospel lesson, not to the palace of the emperor, not to the palace of a king, not to the palace of a governor or a mayor, but He sent Him to a state. As we read in our gospel lesson, because there was no room in the inn, a pregnant Mary and her engaged husband Joseph have to find accommodations in the state. If any of you grew up on a farm, you know that when you put a bunch of livestock in a barn, it doesn't smell very good. And you can use all the Glade fresheners you want, and you can spray all the Lysol you want, and it's not going to make that barn smell any better. And make it worse, let them be wet, and then cover them. And then spend the night, and then wake up to all the fresh manure that they deposited for you. Not a very charming place to go to sleep. And especially not a very charming place to be giving birth to the Savior of the world. But that's what God did. In order to show us that Jesus came not as a king, but as a servant, to tell us that we cannot be too bad for Jesus. He was born to poor parents. Mary and Joseph were nobodies in a nobody's village. As we read later on, when Jesus begins his ministry, Philip comes to Nathanael. He tells him, "We found the Messiah, Jesus of Nazareth." And Nathanael's response is, "Whatever good came out of Nazareth?" That was a reputation of Nazareth. Nothing good comes out of Nazareth. And yet that is where our Lord Jesus Christ was raised. Again, not like Moses in the palace of Pharaoh. Jesus' case would have been the palace of Caesar or King Herod. He was raised in Nazareth, learning the carpenter trade from his father. And then we read that his first visitors were not representatives from the government, not the wealthy, not the high priest from Jerusalem, just a few miles away, and the Levites and the other priests of the temple. His first visitors were shepherds. Now, on our Christmas cards and in our Christmas movies, we kind of romanticize shepherds. We always have them looking nice in nice clothing, and their faces are all scrubbed. Hands were all clean, but that was not the life of a shepherd. Shepherds were some of the most despised people among the Jewish community. They were considered crude, uneducated, rough, and often vulgar. They were listed with the publicans as tax collectors, prostitutes, sailors, camel drivers, and donkey drivers, who were all people who were considered unworthy of God's love and salvation. All because they could not do all the ritual and rules and regulations that the Jewish law required. They could not take time to pray 5 times a day. They couldn't take the time to wash their hands before they ate. They didn't always have time to offer the proper sacrifices. And another thing the community had against them was they were away at home at night. And so being away at home at night, they were unable to protect their women, so this was considered to be dishonorable. Fortunately, they didn't live in modern society where people work second and third shifts in order to make a living. But they were despised. Now, old Santa, what we're told about old Santa, he's surrounded by all these elves that just love him to death, and Mrs. Claus, who mends his outfit, and feeds him, and keeps him fat and jolly, and all year round they play in the North Pole and prepare for the following Christmas, and eat Christmas cookies and Christmas candy, and everything's so wonderful. And then we have Jesus, surrounded by shepherds, some of the most despised of people. But again, this was God telling us that you cannot be too bad for Jesus. That Jesus is not a judge in sin. Jesus is not looking to keep you out of the kingdom, but is welcoming you into the kingdom. Christ died. That's history. Christ died for humanity. That is Christianity. Christ died for you and me. That is salvation. All we have to do is believe in Jesus, and we have entrance into the kingdom of heaven. We do not have to worry about a list of naughty or nice. We don't have to worry about Jesus having a big book where he checks your name every day, and if you've had a good day, he puts a blue mark. If you had a bad day, he puts a black mark. And then when you die, he totals up the black marks and totals up the blue marks, and whichever one is the greatest, that is where you go. In my first parish, I had a woman who was a visitor one day. She'd gone to confirmation class. She was in church. And we were having a conversation, and she said to me, she said, "Pastor, what I really believe is what I just said, that Jesus had in this book where he marks good and bad, and bad are more than the good to go to hell, the good are more than the bad to go to hell." I almost fell off the chair and dropped my cup of coffee. So I cannot believe someone growing up in the Lutheran church all their life would be that misguided. When our church constantly emphasizes the fact that salvation is by grace through faith, apart from works of the law. That salvation is all God's doing. We have no part in it. That is why he sent his son at first Christmas and had him laid in a manger, born in a stall. That is why he sent his son to wander from place to place as an itinerant preacher or itinerant rabbi, so that people would see his humility and his love and his care and his compassion. So you are not too bad for Jesus. It doesn't matter what you've done with your life. Believe in Jesus and he welcomes you with open arms. Because Jesus came to save, you cannot be too bad for him. You may be too bad for Santa. You may wake up tomorrow morning and find a lump of coal in your stocking or a box of coal under the Christmas tree, which happened to my wife and our middle son at Christmas when we had this teenage girl living with us, and she got mad at Gina for some reason, mad at our middle son, and she gave him both a box of coal that she collected from the railroad, side of the railroad. Somebody might do that to you. Santa might do that to you. But Jesus will never do that. Jesus is the true Santa, for he brings us forgiveness of sin and eternal life simply because we believe in his death upon the cross, his resurrection, and his ascension. And we don't have to worry about being naughty. Do not forget the reason for the season. It is the baby. It is the baby's party. It is the baby's celebration. It is the baby's holiday. Don't forget the baby, because you can never be too bad for Jesus. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. We will now sing the first verse of "What Child Is This?" in number 296 in the back. Response tonight is, hear our prayer.
Wonderful Counselor, you increase our joy as the church gathers on this holy night to sing your presence among us. May the story of salvation live in the hearts of all who sing of its wonders. God of grace, hear our prayer. Mighty God, you broke the yoke of sin's burden through the birth of your Son. Comfort those whose burdens distract them from the deeper peace of this holy night, and grant them a restful mind. God of grace, hear our prayer. Everlasting Father, uphold all who are in sorrow or in need of your divine goodness and mercy. We remember with thanksgiving all who have died and all who now rest in your peaceful light. God of grace, hear our prayer. Prince of Peace, may your reign be known in all places of violence and unrest and great resolution to conflicts throughout the world. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Hear our prayers, gracious God, and may this always in the light of your word made flesh through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Those who can, with that difficulty, please stand. Let us pray. God of all creation, all you have made is good, and your love endures forever. You bring forth bread from the earth and fruit from the vine. Nourish us with these gifts, that we might be for the world signs of your gracious presence. In Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. St. John practices an open communion. For all those who are baptized and believe in Jesus Christ as a personal Lord and Savior, who believe his body and blood are truly present as we gather this table in our communion age in your own individual congregation, you're invited and encouraged to come forward with us this day as we gather at the table of the Lord. We continue our celebration with a great thanksgiving on page 152 in the front of your hymnal.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks.
Thanks and praise to Almighty and merciful God, to our Savior Jesus Christ. In the wonder and mystery of the Word made flesh, you have opened the eyes of faith to a new and radiant vision of your glory, that beholding the God made visible, we may be drawn to love the God whom we cannot see. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Christ.
has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Remembering therefore his salutary command, his life-giving passion and death, his glorious resurrection and ascension, and the promise of his coming again, we give thanks to the Lord God Almighty, not as we ought, but as we're able. We ask you mercifully to accept our praise and thanksgiving, and with your word and Holy Spirit to bless us, your servants, and these your own gifts of bread and wine, so that we, and all who share in the body and blood of Christ, may be filled with heavenly blessing and grace, and receiving the forgiveness of sin, may be formed to live as your holy people, and be given our inheritance with all your saints. To you, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory in your holy church, now and forever. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
with his light and truth and love, now and forever. Amen. We conclude with the joy to the world on the opposite side. Thank you.
This concludes our Christmas Eve candlelight service. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. Church services are at 8 o'clock and 10:30 on Sundays. Midweek service at 6:30 in the chapel. Communion's first and third Sunday of the month, every Wednesday evening. Again, thank you for joining us for our Christmas Eve candlelight.